One of the things you can do in an image processing package is resizing images or rotating images and so on. And when you do this in any program, paint.net, Photoshop, the GIMP and so on, you have an option to choose how you want it to scale the pixels. So do you want it to be nearest neighbor or bilinear or bicubic? So today we're going to cover image transformations, but mostly rescaling because it's a simple one. And we'll look a bit at nearest neighbor and bilinear and so on. Let's imagine we've got a 3x3 image. So there's a 3x3 image. It's, you know, it's high quality. And I want to scale this image by a factor of, let's say, 3, okay, which is going to mean a 9x9 image. So cut to a long shot of me going like this frantically. So this isn't going to be 9x9 because not important. It's not important. I don't know how many this is. I haven't counted. It doesn't matter. Right. I'm scaling this, and it extends this way for some indefinite amount of time, depending on what my scaling factor is, okay? Let's leave it at that. Now, if I wanted to scale this, the obvious way to do it is just to multiply these values by some pixel coordinate amount. So let's say x becomes 3x, and put them in this image, and then problem solved, right? So that would be your first guess at how it would work. Let's say it has 120, this is 121, this is, you know, grayscale, let's say, 115, and so on. We say, right, well, this one stays in this corner because this is 0, 0. 0 times a scaling factor of 3 is also 0, so we say this is going to be 120. Okay, that's my first guess at this. 121 is at 1, 0, so it becomes 3, 0. So 0, 1, 2, 3, and it becomes, you know, 121. If this is 100, then 100 goes down here, and this is 110, and that goes over here, and these are all 0, right? Which is about the worst scaling ever. This isn't going to work, right, this approach. It would just look like a black image. If you zoomed really far out, you might see some colours in it, but really, the majority of this image is black and completely useless. So this isn't... I have scaled this image, but not properly, right? Because the problem is that there is no pixel in this image that maps to this one, right? This maps to somewhere between two pixels. So that's the problem we need to solve, right? And that's the problem being solved by nearest neighbor or bilinear or bicubic. So in actual fact, when we want to scale an image, we do this process in reverse. We create the bigger image, and then for each pixel, we look back and see where are we supposed to be getting our sample from. If it's between two pixels, we have to think about what we do. Right? If it's on a pixel, great, we'll just take that pixel value. So,
I mean, my instinct here would be that your 120 would be times 3, so all those 9 would be 120.
Yeah, that's pretty close to nearest neighbor. So what we do here, we say, well, this is a value of 1, 0, which is going to be a third 0 when we scale back. So we're closer to 120 than we are to 121. So this becomes 120, right? This one goes down to 2/3 down here. So it's closer to 121 than it is to 120. So we say that's 121. This probably gets 121 and so on. This is why when you make your image bigger using nearest neighbor, it continues to look pixelated, because that's exactly what it's doing. It's preserving all that information by just duplicating a bunch of pixels in these gaps, right? Now, that doesn't seem like a very good way of doing it, but of course that might be what you want to do. If you're a pixel artist who's doing, you know, pixel art, then scaling it and having it all blur all the edges is completely useless for you. So, you know, depending on what your situation is, you might want to do that. The other thing is that, strictly speaking, then we haven't, in essence, made up any data. This pixel value is still one of the pixel values that was in this original image, because you could argue we don't know for sure what's going on between these two pixels. There could be anything. It's just that the camera isn't high enough resolution to capture it. With bilinear interpolation, what we're assuming is that the thing that's going on between here is entirely obvious. It's just a line between the two. Okay, so we're going to take an average. Let's have a look at some of these. So we've got a value of 120, and we've got a value of 121, right? And this is at pixel 0, and this is at pixel 1. And we're going to be filling in these two gaps here. So this one here is going to be at a value of a third, or 0.3, recurring, and this one's going to be at a value of 2/3. Already, people can probably see what's going to happen here. For this one, we're going to take 2/3 of this and a third of this, and vice versa, okay? So the formula is actually essentially a weighted sum of these two things, but the weighting depends on how far along this distance between them you are. Okay, so this is what linear interpolation does. So in this case, we would say 120 to 121 isn't a very helpful example, because we're going to have to do some rounding at some point and then kind of defeat the whole object of what we're doing. So let's pick a more obvious one. Okay, so let's say that this pixel value is 100 and this pixel value is 200. And we are trying to sample the pixel position a third of the way along. This is very straightforward. So all we have to do is we have to do 2/3 times by 100 plus 1/3 times by 200. right? And if we sum them up, what do we get? This is 66-ish, okay? This is also coincidentally 66-ish. And so we add them up and we get about 132 or something like that. Well, we get 133 recurring, don't we? We get a value exactly a third of the way along from the scale of 100 to 200. Okay? So that's linear interpolation. So the only thing we have to worry about now is how do we extend this to two dimensions? And again, it's not very challenging. So if I just take away this piece of paper, instead of having two endpoints, we now have four. Okay, so we have one here, we have one here, we have one here, and we have one here. And this is x1, y1, and this is x2, y1, and this is x1, y2, and x2, y2. And we're trying to find some position here, x, y. And more often than not, if you're scaling an image or doing a rotation or something along these lines, you're going to find yourself sitting somewhere in between two pixels. What we do is we first interpolate these intermediate values here, okay? So we do what we just did along between this line. So we find this is just about 40%, is it? So we do the formula that says what's the value 40% along from here to here, okay? And we get some value here. And then we do the same here. So what's 40% along here? And we do some value here. And then we interpolate between these two values to get this final value output. And that's how we can map between four values to some arbitrary position in amongst them. Okay? And that's basically what happens when you click bilinear when you want to resample your image. So any kind of scaling, any kind of rotation, anything that is going to involve a scale that doesn't fit exactly on the pixels from the original image. And remember, we're doing this in reverse. So we go from our new image back, we look back into our original image and find out where we need to get the color from. So back to our original example, this x1, y1 is going to be 120, and x2, y1 is going to be 121, and these two are going to be 100 and 110. And we can have any position in between these pixels, depending on what we're doing to our image. If we're making it a factor of 10 larger, then there's going to be 10 increments between these things. If we're making it smaller, there might be fewer than one. You know, it might, you know...
So does that work as well then?
Yeah, so if you're making... So actually, the scaling you're doing makes no difference, right? If the scaling is smaller than one, then you're still going to have pixel values that sit in between the original pixels. There's just not going to be very many of them anymore because you're actually making the image smaller. And the same with a rotation. All that changes is the transform we use to get from these positions in our destination image to these positions in our source image. The only other thing to remember about linear interpolation is that it is just that, linear. If we looked at a row of pixels side on, then you might get a value, if this is zero, you might get a value here, and here, and here, and here, and here, and here, like this, right? So this could be our image. Different intensity levels, right? So just for a grayscale image, we might have something that looks a bit like this if we look side on. Now, if we were just scaling one to one, we're going to be getting this value and getting this value, and that's fine. If we're scaling somewhere a third of the way along, or two thirds of the way between this one and this one, we're going to need to interpolate these values, which corresponds to finding positions along these lines here. And this is what linear interpolation is doing. It's fitting straight lines between these objects and finding the positions along it.
That looks like a very pointed feature that you've just done with those lines. So is it... I'm guessing that we can start drawing curves, right?
That's right. So the problem with bilinear interpolation, and it's not much of a problem if you're just, let's say, resampling by a factor of two or something, so that, you know, you're only creating one intermediate value. It comes down to what our assumptions are about what's happening in the image between these points. It might be more reasonable to say, well, maybe given this underlying data, remember these two aren't part of it, it might be something a lot more like that, you know, a bit smoother. So that if we sample here, it's closer to this one than it is to this one, and so on. Okay? That's what bicubic interpolation does, but that's for a different video. That's 66-ish, okay? This is 66 again, right? So we've done that, we get 120, okay? So, or 120-something recurring. Yeah, let's start that again. So, okay, so this is 66-ish, okay? This is also coincidental.